Bayanihan 3 bill, which aims to provide more aid for Filipinos amid the COVID-19 pandemic, moves forward in the lower house. We have with us now Marikina City Representative Stella Kimbo to discuss this. Congresswoman Stella, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Thanks for having me.
All right. So we have two committees of the House of Representatives already approving 4.5 billion pesos of the Bayanihan 3 measure. So the first question is, do we need it and where will we get the money?
Karen, just a slight correction. It's 405.6 billion pesos.
So we
absolutely need this bill. It's a lifeline for many Filipinos. So it's an ayuda bill. Of course, we know ayuda is the word for help, right? So a lot of our kababayans really need help, especially that the pandemic has been over a year. So it provides ayuda for not only for all households, this is every single Filipino. We've provided for 1,000 pesos and we'll do that in two tranches. And on top of that, we also have assistance provided for affected sectors like your MSMEs, like your indigent patients, teachers, for example, as well as the agri-fishery sector.
Okay, so itong 405 billion pesos, 405.6 billion. Next question muna is, where do we intend to get the money for this, Congresswoman?
Well, so right now, we have the usual savings. So as we know, every year, we tend to underutilize our GAA. So that's one automatic source of funds. Second would be the usual debts. But of course, arguably, we have maxed out our debts. That's what our economic managers keep reminding us about. Third, potentially, we can sweep excess capital in our GOCCs. So we have provided for increasing remittances from GOCCs with excess capital.
Oo. Ang tanong, kailangan pa ba talaga ng Bayanihan 3 in the sense, yesterday I spoke with NEDA's Secretary Carl Chua, and he said as it is, we are operating on three budgets. There's Bayanihan 2 that hasn't been fully spent. There's the 2020 budget, not yet fully spent, and the 2021 budget. So is it released more of the problem?
Well, if you look at Bayanihan 2, Bayanihan 2 only authorized a total of 6 billion pesos for ayuda, and that's gone. And if you look at the 2021 GAA, you're only looking at, a very limited amount of funds in the usual ayuda type programs like DOLES, TUPAD, and DSWD's AICS programs. So you really need to have a new bill that appropriates a bigger amount of money. So this 1,000 pesos per head, per tranche, is already 108 billion pesos. So for two tranches, that's 216 billion pesos. So none of the three operating budgets have that big amount of appropriation for assistance.
And under Bayanihan 3, itong 1,000 peso per head, is it the same that it will only be 4,000 maximum per family?
No. So the idea here is take the number of family members. If there's six in your family, multiply that one by 1,000, you get 6,000 pesos. So that's also the way by which we introduce equity. So as we know, the richer families tend to have smaller number of members, whereas your poor families will have about over six on the average family members. So clearly, if we put a cap, then that's really going to dampen that equity feature of this provision.
Okay, but then are you saying that even the wealthier families, let's not use the word wealthy, middle-class families who have some sort of income will also benefit from this Bayanihan 3 ayuda?
Yes, well, the first principle really is that the pandemic affected everyone, regardless of income class. Number two, as we know, the SAP under Bayanihan 1, We discovered that there were many problems, including a lot of people got excluded. So if you read the Bayanihan 1, it says 75% of all Filipino households would be entitled to a maximum assistance of 8,000 pesos. But as it turns out, because we don't have a listing of families, we don't have yet a national ID system in place, it is very difficult to come up with that list. So we said, okay, Speaker Velasco said, let's try to make things simple. And let's make sure that we have everyone. We make it as inclusive as possible. And so we allotted 1,000 pesos for every single Filipino.
Okay. All
so,
right.
So meaning for our wealthy kababayans, for example, may mga taga Forbes Park, we have a proviso there that allows them to waive, right? So you're not compelled to avail. That's number one. And number two, the way we distribute the ayuda, we normally have it in, for example, public schools. So then obviously for those that are very wealthy, they may not want to be inconvenienced by that kind of distribution mechanism. So that's one natural way by which we limit availment.
So technically, this is a different kind of approach. You're not excluding the middle class and those who can afford from Bayanihan 3, but you are also saying they can choose to waive it. But who will the money go to? Stella, saan ba pupunta yun? Kung binilang sila doon sa 405 billion.
So we put an extra provision where all unused funds in this Ayuda for All program will be realigned to another program, which is the DSWD's AIX. AIX is Assistance for Individuals in Crisis. So it's another, it's an existing program that is also intended to provide ayuda.
Okay. And you're also setting aside 5,000 to 10,000 pesos for families with COVID-infected members. I mean, explain that because it sounds like a lot of money given the numbers of COVID today.
That's right. So as I said, so on top of the basic Ayuda for All, then we would also have on top of that certain assistance that would be targeted for those that are more affected by the pandemic. So the obvious one would be those households with COVID. And as we know, Karen, the problem here is that if there's COVID in your family, even if it's your dad, for example, that has COVID, but then I don't have COVID, or I think I don't have COVID, but then that will not stop me from leaving my house because obviously I have to feed my family. So that's one reason by which we feel like there's a lot of transmission in COVID, meaning we are unable to actually do a complete stay-at-home policy for those households with COVID. So by providing that additional ayuda, they are assured that their basic needs are provided for, so they don't have to leave their home. So that's the rationale for that. For now, what we are saying is that existing programs can actually be used for this purpose. So again, we're talking about the usual AIX under the SWD. And in fact, many of LGUs are actually using this approach, except that the amounts are smaller. So by putting in 5,000 to 10,000 range, we feel that that's really a more reasonable amount.
So technically, if this is passed into law, for example, kung mahirap akong pamilya and we're a family of six, you would have 6,000 pesos. Tapos kung nagka-COVID ang isa sa amin, hypothetically, 6,000 plus 10,000. 16,000 ang pwede naming maiuwi.
Yes, actually, and Karen, there are two tranches for the Ayuda for All. So it's 6,000 pesos for the first tranche. And after 3 months, there's another 6,000 pesos. If you unfortunately get COVID, there's an additional 10,000. And there are other assistance programs. So if, for example, you lost your job, there's also a provision for unemployment assistance. Or if you...
And how much is that?
The usual for Tupad is about 5,000 pesos.
Okay.
But more importantly, we also have assistance for MSMEs, meaning workers. So you're currently employed. You're fortunate to have a job, but you are employed by an MSME. We also have a wage subsidy program. And this is very similar to the wage subsidy program that Secretary Mon Lopez was talking about a couple of days ago. So there's a lot of sort of convergence in ideas between Congress and the executive at the moment.
And you think that this will have the support of Finance Secretary Sunny Dominguez?
Well, you know, Speaker Velasco has been really proactive in trying to build that consensus. And he obviously does not disagree with a lot of the ayuda provisions, meaning it's pretty obvious, Karen, that we really need to provide a lifeline for our kababayans. But of course, being an economic manager, he's really just worried about where to source the funds. And so what they have committed is that they will look for funds. And so that's precisely why now we are looking at GOCCs and the excess capital that would be available in these corporations.
Okay. Moving now to the economy, I wanted to ask you, the NEDA is optimistic that for 2021, the Philippines can recover and restore a 6.5 to 7.5% growth rate, of course, under three conditions, no? For the Philippines not to be risk averse, vaccine deployment, release the recovery packages. But are you seeing, frankly, considering we had a 9.5% contraction, objectively speaking, do you believe we can really grow 6.5 to 7.5% Stella by the end of the year?
Well, Karen, I 100% agree that we can grow, but let me qualify that. That is okay. Called a base effect. You can grow only because you're down there. In other words, nowhere but up. So okay. If we started with a 20 trillion economy before the pandemic, we lost about 10%. So we are down to 18%. So if we move to, let's say, 18.5 or maybe even 19 trillion during the pandemic, or that's still a growth. But then you are still 1 trillion short of your pre-pandemic levels. So it's good news in a sense, but then it's really just the math of it. It's really just a base effect. Yeah. So I hate to be, optimistic and at the same time pessimistic, but that's what it is.
Yeah. Okay. But then for 2022, NEDA is forecasting that we will go back to pre-pandemic levels. But I'm just curious because as an ordinary citizen and as a journalist, you do the math, you look at just the vaccination deliveries and the fact we are on a never-ending some sort of quarantine classification, just the word, you go back to pre-pandemic levels 2022. Do you see that as a possibility?
It all depends on the vaccine rollout. I think that's really, it's very difficult to predict how the rollout would happen at this point in time. The main problem really is that the supply is not yet there. So we're not really seeing the vaccination rate that we think is ideal. I think we're doing, I think just 30,000 per day versus I heard Secretary Galvez say that ideally we should do 468,000 per day. So that's really an ocean of a difference. And of course, the explanation is that the supplies are not yet here. So let's just be hopeful that as soon as, I think we are expecting about 13 million vaccines this month. So we'll see if that comes, then that would really, that's the test, right?
So economically speaking, I mean, you're an expert in this field. What would be the non-negotiables for you to see that 6.5 to 7.5% growth by the end of the year? I mean, so at the very least, you have businesses with something to look forward to, the stock market to be relatively agile again. What would it be? What do we need to do?
Well, number one, again, vaccines, I don't even have to explain that. That's a given. But then to get there, we really have to deal with vaccine hesitation. I recently ran a survey in my district and only 10% said that they want to get vaccinated. And this is Marikina, right? So an urban area. And I wonder about the rural areas, right?
And considering we can't make vaccination mandatory, so if they're hesitant, how can you achieve herd immunity? That's the problem. Right.
Yeah. So that's number one. Number two, public transportation. Right. So even if we reopen the economy, but if there's not enough public transportation, how would people get to work? And that would mean, unfortunately, that government really has to subsidize the compliance to minimum health standards, meaning it's very costly for these drivers and operators to comply with health standards, meaning to put the plastic separators, to disinfect your jeepneys, to make sure that people are seated one seat apart. That means you automatically lose 50% of your revenues. So if you own a Jeep, why would you even make pasada, right? So so there's really subsidies that are required for public transportation. So
and would that be included in Bayanihan 3 or hindi pa?
You know, there's still some amount left under Bayanihan 2. So that's also why we can't put that here. But we have, again, a wage subsidy, and this is for all MSMEs. So if you are an operator, and obviously, like more likely than not, you would be an MSME, then you would qualify for that. So that's number two. Number three, education. We can't leave schooling behind, meaning if we compare ourselves with other countries, I think our disruption in the schooling system is probably one of the longest, right? Many of our neighbors already have their kids going back to school. The problem there is once the pandemic is over, we might lose our edge in the global labor market. So that's, I think we have to think about how we can actually do face-to-face classes, right? So we called for example, making sure that teachers are a priority group for vaccination, because clearly our kids won't be a priority. So if the kids will not be vaccinated, then your school staff, they have to be vaccinated. And number two, your tricycle drivers or GP drivers, because these people take our kids to school. So they also have to be vaccinated. So I think those are my top three.
Okay. I'm curious, you have the local manufacturers the other day already appealing, saying why is it that Chinese PPEs were preferred over the local PPEs? The local PPE market, the local garment industry has set aside 35 billion, I think, pesos, no, if my numbers are correct, you know, just to revive the garment industry in the Philippines. Should there be a policy to that, Stella?
Well, I think part of it is
of Filipino first. Alam mo yon, the Filipino first. Let's say construction is opening. I have businesses asking, will there be a preference, let's say, to local materials, local steel, or are they importing again from China? So I wonder how that plays into our economic growth.
Well, we absolutely agree with you. At this point in time, of course, it may sound anti-competitive, but then, you know, for now, these are really unique times. So we really need to exert extra effort to make sure that there is domestic preference. But I think part of the problem is that there's one provision in Bayanihan 1, which got carried over to Bayanihan 2, which actually gives some preferential treatment to importers. Because remember, when we passed Bayanihan 1, we were so worried about bringing in enough supplies. And so some preferential treatment was given to importers. So what we did now in Bayanihan 3 is we reviewed all of the Bayanihan 1 and Bayanihan 2 provisions and selected only those provisions which we think must be continued. So I think under Bayanihan 3, we'll have a more sort of rational mix of provisions.
I see. So in Bayanihan 3, you will there be a specific notation that if a Filipino company can produce a certain product with the same standard, there should be a preference to the Filipino company? I'm just curious with the wording. How will it go?
Yes. In fact, on top of that, there's a margin that you're allowed. So even if the foreign entity that bids has a bit of a price advantage, your local bidder can still win. So we put in, I can't remember, I think it's a 15% margin. So again, that's our way of promoting domestic preference.
Okay. All right. Can I ask you just a few more questions?
Sure.
Just curious. After the statements of the NTF-LCAC, the spokesperson, General Parlade, there's been some calls to actually defund the NTF-LCAC, which is 19 billion, and frankly, just move it to the needs for COVID. I wanted to ask your point of view. Do you agree with that?
Well, that's actually something that the executive must decide upon. On our end, as far as Bayanihan 3 is concerned, we have a general provision that states that so long as certain programs generate savings. So if, for example, certain programs are just for whatever reason are completely stopped, then savings would be generated. Those savings can actually be used for all of these items in Bayanihan 3. So on our end, it's quite agnostic as to which programs need to be stopped or continued. What we're seeing is that whatever program is stopped and whatever savings are generated, there's a provision in Bayanihan 3 that says you can take those extra funds to use for AYUDA.
Uh-oh. But you have no personal opinion essentially on the actions of the NTF-LCAC in recent days, even calling senators stupid and comparing Ana Patricia Non to Satan, which actually angered some senators, asking them that, it's better just to put the $19 billion to something that was worth it. So I'm curious if you have a personal opinion on that.
Well, those are like two separate matters, whether the program as a whole is completely useless versus how people are expected to behave. I think those are two different matters. As to behavior, there are certain things, as they say, that the most important things you learn in kindergarten. I guess respect is also one of those. So, and I don't think that relates to the program per se. Maybe it's so I don't want to use that as a basis for saying that an entire program must be stopped completely.
Okay. All right. My last question is interesting, given the controversy on ivermectin. You have a colleague of yours, Congressman Mike Defensor and Congressman Marcoleta, distributing ivermectin in Quezon City with doctors in the distribution site. And given your colleagues, and I'm curious, in Marikina, has there been already, have you received questions saying, Congresswoman Stella, gusto namin ang ivermectin? Yun ang tanong ko sa iyo, Stella. The actions of your colleagues, has it spread to other cities, no? Given the fact that they were giving it for free?
Well, number one, Karen, I have zero requests for ivermectin from my constituents. So this is something that I did not have to act on as a representative. Yeah. Number two, I think it's really a regulatory issue. Me, so long as it is allowed by the FDA, then why not? But at this point in time, it's really case to case, meaning if your hospital has a compassionate drug use, then you can use it. So I'm quite conservative in that sense, meaning whatever is allowed by regulators, why not? But at this point in time, I'd rather wait. But again, that's a personal opinion. Of course, I would respect my colleagues, whatever they feel like their constituents need.
All right. On that note, Congresswoman Stella Kimbo of Marikina, thank you for joining me this morning. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.